ask, answer. Character. And event. Every story is made up of these elements. There are exceptions. Terry Bisson's They Are Made of Meat really has no milieu. It's all dialogue all the time. But, for the most part, every story is made up of these in differing amounts. That's why it's called a quotient, because the amount shifts. One of these is going to be your major driver. What these each represent is a story question that the reader buys into and is waiting to have answered. So, a milieu story begins when your character enters a place. It ends when they leave it. For the moment, I'm going to talk about these as single threads, as if none of the other elements exist. I'm going to talk about how we combine them in a minute. So we're just going to worry about singles right now. So milieu begins when you enter a place. It ends when you leave it. Which means that the story question you're working with is, can they get out, essentially? Will they get there? Because being on a journey, the journey itself can count. You do not have to return to the same place. That means all of the conflicts in a milieu story are designed to stop your character from getting out. Any questions about what a milieu story is? Gulliver's Travels, Around the World in 80 Days. Okay. Ask, answer. It begins when you ask a question. It ends when you answer it. Moving on. mystery stories. The original Sherlock Holmes are classic ask-answer stories. There's very little character going on in a classic Sherlock Holmes. You begin when you ask a question, when the main character asks a question. Let me rephrase that. When the main character asks a question and it ends when they answer it. So all of your conflicts in an ask-answer story are designed to keep them from answering the question. Questions about ask-answer? I know. I love that one too. Character. I'm going to go ahead and warn you right now, people always confuse character and event. Okay. Character stories are about internal conflict. Your character's self-definition is precious and sacred to them. Everybody has a self-definition. Character stories begin when that self-definition is challenged. Basically, when the character is unhappy with an aspect of self. And it ends when they have reached a self-definition that they are comfortable with. Now, comfortable does not mean happy. But you can have someone who's like, all right, sorry, it's too soon for that one. I'll go ahead. I desperately want to be the first female president of the United States. I am comfortable with the fact that I am not. Not happy. None of us are happy. But that's that the new self-definition solidifies. Mm-hmm. Yes.
So is it more like acceptance instead of being comfortable? It's just like they fully grasp that?
Yeah, it is acceptance. Thank you. That is a much better way to say that. This one breaks down very easily. The character goes through denial, resistance, exploration, and acceptance. I don't have time to actually drill down into each of these individually, but that one is very, very simple. And then the last thing is materialization of character. You accept something and then you act upon it. How does it manifest? How does it materialize, that acceptance? But basically, you begin with a character who is dissatisfied with self, and at the end, they have a self-definition that has solidified. But let me be very clear, it is an internal conflict. Frequently, and this is why people get them confused, frequently these two are paired. Mm-hmm. Because an event story is about an external conflict, and often the event will kick off the confusion about self-identity. Like, if you have been fired, that is an external event. If being fired just messes with... let me explain event, and I will explain the difference. Event is an external conflict. It begins when your status quo is challenged, is disrupted, actually. It begins when your status quo is disrupted, and it ends with a solidification of status quo, either the old status quo being restored or a new status quo. And everybody dies counts as a status quo. So, oh no, an asteroid coming at the Earth. Everybody dies. That's a new status quo. So is, we've managed to blow it up. Yay! Only some of the people died. Hurrah! Because we ignored physics. I'm writing a novel right now in which a meteor, an asteroid, slams into the Chesapeake Bay, so I've just done a lot of research about this. Oh, those movies. But that's an external conflict. So you can have an external conflict that causes a character to have internal self-doubt. But that doesn't mean that just because a character's status quo is disrupted that they are having an existential crisis. Mm-hmm. So character stories are coming-of-age stories, romances, things like that. Event stories are basically things like asteroids dropping on the Earth. Inferno. Inferno is pretty much pure event. There's really nothing else going on there. All right, questions about any of those? Yes.
I'm having some trouble with Milieu and event and how they differ. It seems like they're both sort of external forces in how you resolve the situation.
Sure. I'm resolving my situation right now. As I said, most of these things are paired with something else. So a Milieu story can be as simple as, I am locked in this room. This is not, you know... Or this is actually a better example, because that one would be a surprise. If a Milieu story, if you have explorers who go to a planet specifically to explore the planet, all of the things that happen there are part of their status quo because they are explorers, even if they are stopping them from getting back to the ship and off the planet. So as long as it's stopping them from getting off the planet, that's a Milieu. If they have a breakdown of the ship, that then before they land on the planet, then you have an event story with a Milieu story, because they also have to restore the status quo of having a working ship.
That's what kicks off the story.
Yes.
Good evening, students.
Good evening, Principal Sabourin.
Red team, check in.
We're five, stand by.
Hi.
Gold team, check in.
I think that says a lot.
Everybody say what you think of the blue team. This is Principal Sabourin with a few brief evening announcements. A reminder that tomorrow we will be in Loreto, starting at 11 a.m. Will you all please follow the shore excursion and tendering instructions just the way you did today? Except tomorrow. Ship's staff just informed me that they plan to film all of you doing the tendering process and then show it to all of their other future guests to show them the gold standard of tendering. I'm not kidding about that, they just said that in here. A reminder regarding the food festival. Tickets are $25 in U.S. cash only. If you need cash, you can get it from the ship's guest services department in the atrium on Deck 1. They are open 24 hours. A few brief announcements. The sign-up sheets for the Sea Monkey open mic that is happening Wednesday night are available at the Helper Monkey Info Desk, also on Deck 1 in the atrium. The ship's IT department has been working very hard. And the internet is back!
Yay!
Technically, the internet never went anywhere. We can just access it again. Finally, thank you all. You are all extremely fancy. Seen many fine fezzes and tiaras and mustaches. We wish to give a special shout out to the bar and wait staff of the Lido pool area for their fine use of mustaches this evening. Woo! Special international foods available in the Lido market. Also, the main dining room is available, open seating until 9 p.m. Enjoy the rest of your evening, and we'll see you tomorrow in Loreto.
Do I have? Yes, I do.
Yes.
All right. So I'll use the event milieu as an example. So now we're going to go on to what happens. I adjust my status quo. What happens when you have more than one thread going on? Which is the way most stories work. Those of you who, some of you are immediately going to be like, okay, and then leave, because I will have explained everything. Nesting code, done. Everybody else. You have to open, whatever you open first is the last thing you close. So first in, last out. So if, for instance, we begin with an event, then we go into a milieu, you have to close the milieu before you can close the event. When you have stories that feel like they end and then end again and then end again, two towers, frequently what has happened is that the nesting tags at the end have been inverted. So here is where I give you a very concrete example of how this works using Wizard of Oz, the movie, not the books. It doesn't work that way. Okay. My favorite thing I have to say is when people take a picture of this and it and says, Mary explained it all right now because it just looks like junk. Wizard of Oz begins as a character story. Dorothy
is...
Is
that on the stage?
What? I do, but I'm afraid it's going to fall over. Yeah.
Hit the plunge. I'm trying to avoid the plunge. That's the... Thank you.
Ah, look how well that worked. Thank you. That's why fezzes are cool. Okay, so Wizard of Oz begins with Dorothy. She is dissatisfied with her role as a Kansas farm girl. Then we have an event. Tornado! Then we have a milieu. Welcome to Oz. And then we have an ask. What do the ruby slippers do? Dorothy then goes through Oz. She arrives at the end where Glinda says, oh, the ruby slippers would carry you home. Bitch. Because, I mean, honestly, if she'd said that at the beginning, everything would have been a lot faster. Mm-hmm. Then Dorothy leaves Oz, which closes out the milieu. Then she arrives back in Kansas, where everything is perfect. Again, closing out the event. And then she says, I didn't have to go looking any farther for adventure than my own backyard. Closing out character. Really cool. Here's where it gets even more interesting. So any questions about how that nesting works? Because it's pretty straightforward. Okay, so the length of your story is equal to the number of characters you have plus the number of locations times 750, which is the average of 500 to 1,000 words. That gives you the length of your story with one to two mace threads. If you have more than two, and really if you have two, if you have more than one, you should multiply, and we'll just pretend that this is over here. Actually, I've got the space. Multiply that whole thing by 1.5. Because each 1.5m, right there, just pretend the m is there. Each of those mace elements can make your story half again as long. Sorry, what? Oh, yes. Length of story, LS, equals open parentheses, C, plus L, close parentheses, times 750, close parentheses, times 1.5m. Now you know everything. You're like, you did not tell me there would be math. Did that?
I was actually just curious what the C and L were.
Oh, character and location. Yes.
When you said that each mace thread can make 50% as long, again, do you expect that to be a square, like 1.5 to m, or only 1.5 to m?
You count the number of mace elements you have and multiply those mace elements by 1.5.
Okay.
How does that express with math?
Just...
Great! Good. All right. So let me explain how this works. Because the moment I start doing this, you'll be like, oh yeah. If you remember Wizard of Oz, at the beginning of the film, in the running away portion, Dorothy goes and talks to Professor Marvel, who tells her, you really don't need to go looking any farther for adventure than your own backyard. Had she taken his very good advice and just gone home, she would not have needed any of this. We would have gone straight from character to closed character. It would have been a satisfying little coming-of-age film. It would not have been Wizard of Oz, I grant that. But it would have been a satisfying little coming-of-age film. Dramatically shorter. If, on the other hand, we had cut the character portion. Let's say that Dorothy begins the thing, and she's actually totally satisfied being a Kansas farm girl. She's got no problems with it at all. So we just begin with Tornado. When we arrive in Oz, we do not need to meet the Tin Man, the Cowardly Lion, or the Scarecrow, because those characters are all there to teach Dorothy something about herself. The story gets longer again. She can still have all of those adventures, but you've just cut a number of characters. The story gets shorter. So you see, if Glinda had just answered the fucking question at the beginning, dramatically shorter, that ask-answer just goes away. So you see what happens when you start mucking about with these. So what happens to people when they are writing short fiction is that they try to get too many characters in, too many locations, and too many mace elements. So, let's talk about how you come up with a story. Any questions about... Yeah, I thought there might be.
Before you go on, can you talk a little bit about location? So
oh, sorry, yes, I
like, she's walking down the Yellow Brick Road.
Yeah, yeah.
How do you define that in location terms?
Yes, excellent question, and I'm sorry, I actually skipped over that part because I was distracted by trying to not feedback, or cocktail. I'm going to blame it on something other than teaching. When I'm talking about character and location, character means slightly different things depending on whether you're talking about a short fiction or a novel. Location means the same thing, which is... anytime you have to move. So, if you think about it this way, if you think about it as a screenplay, if you have to write a new bracket about new location, that's a new location. So, what I'll see people say is, oh, it all takes place just at the castle. It's like, no, it takes place in the kitchen of the castle, in the library of the castle, in the gardens of the castle, in the parapet of the castle. These are all different places. So if you would have to pick up a camera and physically walk it to a different place, it's a different location. So along the Yellow Brick Road, she's not just along the Yellow Brick Road. She is in the Enchanted Forest. She is in Munchkin Land. She's in the Field of Poppies. So each of those counts as a different location. If it were truly just a yellow brick road with nothing else around her, freaky, but that would be a single location. Okay, so that's location. Do you have a follow-up on that? Okay, character. So character, and again, this is a slight difference between short fiction and novels, but it's a proportional thing. What you're looking at is, basically in short fiction, your metric is, do they have a name and do they have any lines? That is a character. But this is because proportionately, you're going to be giving them more lines than that same number of lines would be in a film. So, for instance, if I have a scene in a coffee shop, there are three people. There's a man and a woman having a conversation and a waitress. If the waitress has 50% of the lines that are said, even if those are only 10 lines, and it's a 20-line script, she's a character. If I take that exact same scene and I put it in a film and that man and woman are in the entire film and that waitress only has 10 lines in the entire film, she's a minor character. She's a background character. So that's why I say it's a proportional thing. In a short, story, the easiest metric is if you name them, particularly if you name them in your synopsis before you start writing, that's a character. This includes dogs. Because nonverbal language counts. Did that answer the character questions? Good. Did you have a different one?
I did. You said before that romance is a character
yes.
question. I'm trying to, and maybe it's in my own failing and not understanding character versus event, but I would have thought it was a combination character and event.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
If it were only one, then why it would be a character?
Sure. I'm so lonely. Now I'm married! Okay. Great. That was easy. The other side is, I'm a charming, witty philanthropist. No, you're an asshole. No, I'm a charming... What do you mean? I'm not an asshole. No, you're an asshole. I'm an asshole. But I want to be a charming, witty philanthropist. I must change, and then I will win the woman of my dreams. Great. Good. Any other questions that I can answer by doing some radio theater? How do I get home is the question that drives a Milieu story. Remember, each of these is driven by a question. So Milieu is, how do I get home? Character story is, how am I happy? How do I become happy? Events. Ask answer is, what is the answer to this question? Yeah, I know, it's a very recursive one. Why is this dead body on the floor? Ask-answer question is, I would like to know the answer to this. So there, and this is why it's a quotient. You will very rarely see any story that is pure any of these. And most of them are really, really dull. So yes, and ask-answer, a Milieu story does have elements of ask-answer going on in it. But when you are, the reader is not... The reader is not happy with the ask answer when Glinda says the ruby slippers will carry you home. Dorothy hasn't left. That Milieu is still open. The Milieu does not close until she gets out. So I guess actually the story question that the reader is asking here is, will they get out? Anyone else? Okay. Yes.
There's often like sublocations with their own. Will I get out of this sublocation when you get home? Like you go to a subplace and you close that subplace. Is it always strictly guessing, even when things open and close within other?
Yes and no. In short fiction, almost always yes. In novels, you generally have multiple things going on simultaneously. But this is a short story class. So I'm not actually going to talk about braiding, which is a different technique, only because I don't have enough time. Let's say my character, say that I have an overall Milieu story going on. I can have minor Milieu things happen within it. Like Dorothy has the larger Milieu of I need to get out of Oz, but then there's a smaller Milieu that happens somewhere in here where she needs to get out of the castle. But she has to get out of the castle before she can close out getting out of Oz. So they are still nested, but there are multiple things going on simultaneously. And you can have threads that run in parallel to each other.
She starts having a problem with the witch outside the castle, and then resolves the witch in the castle, and then leaves the castle.
Right, but that's the event. That's still part of event.
Okay.
So the problem with the witch, so the way that one would work is we have another event here, which is witch shows up. Actually, I think the witch shows up here after the ruby slippers. We'll just pretend that I wrote that in the right place. But we're still in Oz. Okay? We're still in Oz. Then we get a mini milieu here, which I'm writing sideways. We get a mini milieu here, where she is in the castle. Oh, I see what you're saying. Actually, this is a really good example. You can have the same plot point close out both things.
Okay.
So, melting of the witch frees her from the castle, and she returns to the status quo, which is continuing on her way to Oz. So, it is the same plot point that is closing out both things. Did that?
Yeah.
Okay.
But it would be dissatisfying if she killed the witch, but then we're stuck in the castle for another reason.
Correct. Let me give you an example of why it really messes with readers. It's the ones you really have to worry about are your closing ones. Let's take the event, which is the status quo disrupted by the tornado. You remember in the witch's castle, you see Aunt Em in the hourglass, and she's like, "Dorothy! Dorothy!" That scene exists to remind you that the status quo is still disrupted. If we had seen Aunt Em in that hourglass and she had been perfectly happy sitting on the front porch, farmhouse has been restored, it's clear that the status quo has been restored and they don't actually need Dorothy for the status quo. Then when Dorothy gets out of Oz and returns to Kansas, there's a letdown because you already know the answer. That thread is no longer one of the things that is pulling you through the story. So that's why the closing tags are the ones that you really need to stress about. The tags in the middle, you only, if they are not working for a reader, it's worth looking to see if your tags are closing in the right order. But often, it is a matter of moving a sentence, not an event. Because, and this is another thing that I should have said, we'll pretend that this is exactly where I've always intended to say this. These things represent when you introduce the idea to the reader, not when they happen in a linear timeline. Flashbacks, that's why flashbacks work when they work, and why they fail when they don't fail, when they don't work frequently. Sometimes they fail just because they're dull. But it has to do with when you are introducing the information to the reader. So she melts the witch, and that's releasing her from the thing, but the event doesn't actually really close until she is reunited with the lion and the tin man and the scarecrow, and they are returning back to Oz. Okay? Great. Anybody else? Okay. Let me see where I am on time.
17 minutes.
Thank you. Cause story bloat and how to avoid it. And if you have begun trying to write a short story and then you're suddenly like, oh, look, this is a novelette, I think I'm in the process of writing a novel and potentially the first in a Brandon Sanderson series of Chihuahua killers. What happens is you go off track with your conflicts. So, all of those quotients can be answered with very simple questions, or very simple questions, very simple answers. So, a milieu story, the question that is driving you is, are they going to get out? Yes, happy ending. No, tragedy. Either of those end the story as soon as you have a definitive answer. These two, yes but, no and, keep a story moving forward. What this means is, yes, whatever it is that they've just tried worked, but things have gotten worse. Or, no, whatever it is that they've tried did not work, and things have gotten worse. You see his pattern here. as an author, your job is to systematically deny your reader, your character, their goal. Your job is to be evil. You are the antagonist, really, when it comes down to it. So let's use a really simple example. Characters trapped in a room. Okay? So the thing you do when you're plotting this is you say, what is the smartest thing my character can do with the resources at hand? So you're in a room. This is a room that has four white walls, no windows, plain floor, plain ceiling, and a door with a doorknob. What is the smartest thing you can do?
Open the door.
Open the door. Great. Does the door open? Yes, but... Oh, no, actually, I'm going to do that. I'm not going to do that yet. Does the door open? No, and you get electrocuted. Actually, not electrocuted. You just get shocked, because electrocution is actually when you're dead. And that would just be a no again. So, no, and you get shocked. What's the smartest thing that you can do? I'll say that you're wearing wool, just because I'm going to guide you a little bit. What's the smartest thing that you can do if you're facing an electric doorknob?
Cover your hands.
Cover your hands. Okay. Does that work? Yes, but when you open the door, sand comes pouring into the room. So you see how this kind of steps you through. Mm-hmm. What breaks is when, instead of a yes, but, you get a yes, and. Does the door, are you able to open the door? Yes, and your sister calls, and she has questions about what dress she should wear to her wedding, and what color she should be doing, and you're like, oh my goodness, I am such a bad sister, because I am not there, I'm trapped in this room with sand pouring in. That introduces a character thing. Mm-hmm. Which now you have to answer the character question. So where people go wrong when they are plotting is that in order to ramp up the tension, you will introduce a conflict that is not on a direct line with that thread. It's not a logical consequence. So all of these yes but no ands should be logical consequences of the action that they just took. It can be stuff that they couldn't have anticipated, absolutely, but it needs to be a consequence. If it is unrelated, then you have just introduced a new story thread. Questions? Yes.
What is an example of a no but?
A no but. Let's see. Is she able to open the door? No, but her cell phone battery dies. It's like, well, that doesn't actually affect anything that she's doing right now. Mm-hmm. But it totally affects her ability to talk to her sister.
Someone from an improv background where yes and is the only thing we are taught.
Yes, and. It means two different things in improv in here. What yes and yes and actually works for this as well for world building. Yes and means I accept your reality, I live in your reality, and I'm going to add to your reality. So it works great for world building. Works great for characters, but yes and is designed to avoid conflict between the two people who are playing on stage. This is conflict with your character, and your character is in conflict with you, the writer. Does that help?
I think so.
You've played New Choice?
Yes.
This is New Choice.
Reality that's
yep.
presented immediately for
yes.
your character.
Yes. I'm not going to explain that to everyone else. Anyone else have questions? Also, thank God I have an improv background. Okay. So I have 10 minutes, according to my clock. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to take a classic story that everybody knows, Little Red Riding Hood, and I'm going to give you 3 minutes, 3 to 5. Sorry, I'm like, is this the best use of my 5 minute? I could lose all of my time just thinking about it. I'm going to give you just a few minutes to take Little Red Riding Hood and turn it into a straight up character story. Red Riding Hood is classically an event story. A little girl, she's a wolf, eating grandma, there's a lot of event stuff going on. If it were structured as a character story, what do you think it would look like? Remember from the Wizard of Oz example that you can jettison all of the elements you don't need. For instance, if I wanted to write Goldilocks and the Three Bears as a straight-up character story, Goldilocks was tired of being treated like a child. See, dissatisfaction right there with self. She went on adventures, discovered red bears, realized that actually being treated like a child was much safer. So that is predominantly a character story. Or I could do Mama Bear had always wanted to be a great porridge chef. But Papa Bear and Baby Bear didn't appreciate her porridge. It was always too hot or too cold. She knew, though, that she had it within her to be a great porridge chef. Disconsolate, they took her to a picnic, trying to console her. She made sandwiches, but those were not what she wanted to make. She wanted to make porridge. They return home, and someone has eaten her porridge. Mama Bear is a great porridge chef, and she has found her audience, little blonde girls. So you see what happens when you pick one of these things. So I want you to take Little Red Riding Hood, those of you who have paper and want to play, and take a few minutes and do that. Or not, since none of you are moving. All right, so we'll do a different thing, since you are all wimps. Sorry, that was... You are all wimpy sea monkeys.
Yes, but...
Yes. Yes, I was... See, my status quo is totally disrupted, because my status quo involved you doing that exercise, and you all just yes-butted me. Yes, but they don't want to. All right, here's the other thing. This is actually a structure thing that I should have said, that is useful and practical, and you don't have to do the exercises in class. When you're writing a short story, for me, do this thing. Your first sentence, I should be able to tell your genre. I should be able to tell where you are. And in an ideal world, I should be able to tell who your main character is, but I'll be okay if I don't know who your main character is until the second sentence. But you have to give me something to ground me in that first thing, in that first sentence. Within the first three lines, I definitely need to know who your character is and what they want in that moment. I don't need to know the giant conflict, but I need to know an immediate want. Within the first 13 lines, which is the first half page in standard manuscript format, for a short story, which is something under 7,000 words, I should know what your major conflict is. Or at least, when I say major conflict, I should know which of the mice quotient threads is driving you. Just do that for me, please. Please do not write the story that begins with prologue. Because I have, in the slush pile, received a 4,000-word story that began with a 2,000-word prologue. That is not a good choice. At all. Any other questions? We can just use our remaining time for questions, or I can release you to go be Kraken.
Just wondering if this qualifies for the character question, if Red Riding Hood's grandmother is worried that her grandmother, that her Red Riding Hood doesn't love her.
Yes. So her question was, if the story began with Grandma and focused on Grandma, and Grandma is worried that Little Red Riding Hood doesn't love her, yes. Specifically, if she is worried that it is because she's a bad grandma, yeah, that's absolutely a character story. Yeah. Little Red Riding Hood's grandmother was... that would be a good one.
From the point of view of the wolf.
The wolf had always wanted to be a painter. But he had difficulty getting past his animal nature and opposable thumbs. And when he met a little girl, he thought she would be the perfect subject for me to paint. I can just get her to come here in the flowers and let me just paint you here. But then she mentions her grandma, and he's like, oh, but grandma would be an even better subject. And so he races ahead of Little Red Riding Hood because he thinks, I could surprise her by painting her grandma, and then maybe when she comes, I could paint both of them together. But then he meets grandma, and she smells so good.
She's so delicious.
She smells like apple pie and cinnamon and roasting flesh, and she is well seasoned, and he just means to tuck her hair behind her neck, but his claws without the opposable thumbs slip, and then there's blood, and he can't contain himself, and he eats grandma and realizes that no matter how much he wants to be a painter, he is a wolf. That would be a character story.
Yeah.
Also, thank God I have an improv background. Let me go there, and then there, and then there. Now that you know it's not completely bullshit. Yeah. You all can come up and jot it down after. Yeah.
This is more of a stylistic question. I recently read a column by Robert Silverberg where he bemoaned the usage of over thesaurus when people are doing conversation.
Yes.
He yelled, he moaned, he cried, he grunted, he whispered under his breath, and he went back and said, just say they said it. Where do you land on that?
Okay. So this question is Bob Silverberg complained about basically people using too many adjectives instead of just they said. He moaned, he cried. I am of the philosophy that you should actually avoid dialogue tags when you can. That a properly rendered piece of dialogue with the accompanying action will tell you how a phrase is said. For instance, what did you say? This is a fairly ambiguous phrase. Could mean a lot of different things. Mm-hmm. What did you say? He fiddled with his hearing aid. What did you say? She leaned away from the speakers bearing punk rock music dialed to 11. Mm. What did you say? The principal opened the drawer and set the paddle in the middle of the desk. What did you say? Your mom put her hands on her hips. You know exactly how each of those things is said. So I am of the opinion that you generally don't need dialogue tags at all. When you do need them, I think that they are there to remove ambiguity or to add emphasis. So the removing ambiguity is when you need to make sure that the reader knows actually who said that thing. Or sometimes you do need, there is no way to avoid the ambiguity of the language, and so you do need to emphasize it. I don't think there's anything wrong with saying, he whispered. I think these words exist for a reason. I think that they can absolutely be overused. And at one point, and it's not taught as frequently now, so I'm betting this is an older column by Bob. But at one point, students were taught that you should never use the word said, and that you should always use something else. I am somewhere in middle land, which is that I think that you don't need it. I think it's a perfectly good word. I think there are other perfectly good words. The only one I would say don't use is he ejaculated. All right. Am I out of time?
One more.
I think that was you.
Yeah.
You.
Thank you. Honestly, it's a curious question. Is I just for inquiry for the mice?
That would have been so much easier than changing it. Maybe I can go back. It was for idea.
Okay.
And explaining idea to people was well nigh unto impossible. And since I was always going, begins when you ask, it ends when you answer, I'm like, oh, look. And plus, with mace, you can beat the story into submission. Mice, you just kind of scream and run away a little bit. Or perform experiments.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, someone else recommended... was it, Brandon? Brandon said change this one. Oh, Brandon said that we should flip character and milieu, so it'd be character as answer setting an event. Case. I was like, I'm already changing things about a technique that people have been teaching for over a decade. I'm just going to change that one letter and be happy about it. But I still have to footnote it. All right. So I am out of time. Time to release you back to your fez and tiara festivities and mustaches and things. Those of you who have not heard, I'm doing writing dates at 10 o'clock on the Lido pool deck in the morning. So if you are working on fiction, please come join me. And otherwise, I'll see you guys around. Thanks so much.
Hey guys. Who put all these speakers here?
Come back to me. Come to me.
Thank you.
Hi, Kevin.
Hi.
Hi, Kevin.
So there is another event here at 8 o'clock. Show of hands, who's sticking around for the? Yeah, that's very funny. But what's your real job or whatever? Handful of you. Okay. Honor system. We're supposed to clear the rooms. If the handful of you who are staying could make sure that the people coming in are definitely getting seats, I'd very much appreciate that, because I don't want to kick you out of the bar. Everyone else, you're welcome to stay around in this area, but this particular staging area, we'd appreciate if you clear out so the people coming in for the next event can find seats and enjoy it. That's it. Thank you very much.
Woo!